Good morning and welcome to the 23rd meeting of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee. Our first item of business this morning is to decide whether we are taking item 3 in private and to consider pre-budget correspondence or its report in private at future meetings. Are we all agreed? Thank you very much. And before we turn to our main items of business today, I wanted to confirm to the committee that we have published our report on kinship care, and that is now available on our website. There's been some social media activity about it, so I would encourage you all to share that if you can. That would be fantastic. And we now turn to our first item of business, which is the first of our pre-budget scrutiny sessions. This focuses on resource spending review and its impact on poverty, as well as the forthcoming Equality and Fair Scotland budget statement. And I welcome to the meeting panel one, first off, who are Dr. Alison Hosey, who is Research Officer at the Scottish Human Rights Commission, and Sarah Cowan, who is the Coordinator of the Scottish Women's Budget Group. Welcome to you both this morning. A few housekeeping points to mention before we kick off. Please allow our broadcasting colleagues a few seconds to turn your microphones on before you start to speak. And make sure that you can see the chat box in the corner. Put an R in that chat box. I've got it up on my screen here as well, so I can make sure that I bring you in as appropriate. And we do have colleagues on from the committee. We've got Natalie Dawn, who is remote as well, so I'll be keeping an eye on that as well. So we've got around 1 hour this morning for this first panel. And I'm now going to turn to members and invite them in to come in questions. And to start us off this morning, I'm going to turn to my colleague Emma Roddick, who's going to come in on the theme of poverty as a rights violation. Over to you, Emma. Thanks.
Thank you, convener. Good morning. My first question is to Dr. Alison. And thinking about the human rights approach to budgeting, I wondered what your take is on the Scottish Government directing support at the moment towards supporting Ukrainian refugees, you know, through housing, through access to social security, and whether you consider this a human rights approach.
And who would you like to
direct that to?
Dr. Hosey.
Good morning. Thank you very much for the invitation to speak today, and thank you very much for your first question. I think what the government has chosen to focus on are issues of human rights concern. I don't, however, think that they have taken a rights-based approach to the decisions that they have made, if that makes sense. The Scottish Government doesn't treat poverty currently as a rights violation, but there is growing acknowledgement of areas of concern, human rights concern and poverty. But it's not yet translating into kind of meaningful accountability. In terms of I suppose, taking the approach, we would like to see the government thinking through the process of what their rights obligations are before they're coming to decisions around where they have to prioritise. Now, in the current situation with Ukrainian refugees, this is an issue of a very timely situation. It's time pressure decisions that have to be made in relation to the budget. And those decisions are well-meaning, but they aren't taking a structured approach. We don't have that particular type of approach in place at the moment.
Okay, and kind of thinking about the alternatives, you know, within the fixed budget, we have just seen the new programme for government. Is there anything in there that you consider to be, you know, gratuitous in terms of this money should have been put towards tackling poverty?
I think my first point is I can't make an assessment, an adequate assessment, because I don't know what the workings are in the margin. I haven't seen evidence of how those decisions have been made. Without knowing how the decisions have been made, knowing what the processes are that have been taken, we haven't got any way of giving a considered opinion about whether the choices they took a human rights-based approach. In the briefing that Spice produced, there was an example of the prioritisation of wage increases over spending on employability. And in order to assess whether or not that was a correct decision, I would want to know, you know, do they envisage employability spending being reinstated? Who's going to be affected by that particular decision to cut employability focus rather than wage enhancement on the other? Who benefits from the employability spend? Is, you know, women, parents, lone parents, people with disabilities? Are those same people the ones who are going to benefit from wage increases? Now, I'm not preempting the answer to that. I don't know, because I haven't seen the assessment of how they came to that decision. If it was done, nothing was published, and therefore we have to assume it's not in the public domain. It's not available to us, therefore it's not transparent. And what other options, you know, were considered? So this is your question, the point of your question. We don't know what other options were considered, whether there are other areas of spend that could have been taken as a cut before these cuts were made. And also, I think, I know it's difficult in Scotland, but I would say that one thing that we can consistently come back to in and around resources is looking at finding more of them in taxation. And we don't use the maximum that we can at the moment. I'm sure that's something we'll come back to later on in relation to generation of resources. But one of the human rights obligations that we have is that we must look to all sources of resource generation before we make cuts. So, again, it's about not knowing what the process was at the government to be able to make any considered opinion around whether there were other areas within the budget that they could have made different decisions with.
Thank you. That's really helpful.
Thanks for that, Emma, and thanks for your answer, Dr. Hosey. I'll now turn to my colleague, Pam Duncan-Glancy, to come in on this theme as well. Pam?
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to Alison and Sarah. Thank you for joining us. Thanks also for the information that you've submitted in advance. It's really helpful, as ever. My first question, I guess, is to Alison directly, but I think, Sarah, you may want to also come in on it. Do you believe the government has maximised its available resources to deliver on its human rights outcomes?
I'm going to give a non-politician answer and say no. That's a straight one for you. I think we don't... When you look, for example, at the recent review of the tax framework and kind of putting in new principles, there was a missed opportunity there to have as a core principle that the government must maximise its available resources in order to generate the resources it needs. The way that we budget, we start with, here's the budget, all of the portfolio areas work out how much budget they're going to have, it's divided up. Instead of starting with what are we trying to achieve, what outcomes does our budget want to service, what policies and programmes do we need to put in place to do that, how much are they going to cost, how are we going to generate the resources to meet that. And we don't take that process at the moment. So we don't start from thinking about, I always like to think about pie, is our pie big enough to start with? You know, rather than here is your pie and that's your allotted slice. We have a lot of options, not as many because of the reserved devolved nature of taxation, but we need to be more politically bold about taking the opportunity to review our tax options, particularly around local taxation. I always kind of am amazed by the fact that our finance minister was 1 year old the last time council tax bans were reviewed. We just need to, there's been lots of discussion around how we could do this better, and we need to get on with it. We could be looking at how we tax wealth versus how we tax income, which is very different. We could be looking at local taxations. I'm not a tax expert. I'm not going to suggest that, you know, there are whichever policies are particularly best. But the government should be looking at these issues and looking at them with their human rights obligations in mind.
Thank you, Dr. Hosey. That was really, really clear. Sarah, do you have anything to add to that?
I agree very much with what Alison has been saying in terms of maximisation of resources. I suppose just to add the equality perspective onto it as well. In Scotland, as in the rest of the UK, we have an unequal taxation of income rather than wealth, and this tends to represent a tax break for wealthy men. So I think there's been progress in Scotland in terms of income tax and a progressive look on income tax, and we've seen that bringing more low-income women out of paying as much tax, but we need to look at what can be done what further can be done in terms of potential wealth taxes, and as Alison said, looking at local tax reform, because we see the regressive nature of that on households.
Thank you very much. I have just have one further question in this area. Thanks, Convener. It's also again for you, Sarah, if this is okay. In your submission, you talk a lot about unpaid carers and the impact that the care economy can have on women's poverty. What support have you been able to identify from the budget that is there to support unpaid carers?
In terms of the resource spending review or this year's budget?
The spending review, actually.
We've seen in the resource spending review a welcome prioritisation around health and social care, and an announcement of an increased investment within health and social care, which could bring benefits to unpaid carers. But at the moment, it's unclear how those funds will be spent and where they'll be prioritised within health and social care. So there's not enough detail within the documents of the impact that's going to have when it comes to unpaid carers in particular, but across the board really on how that will impact people who are receiving support as well. I would say that while it's really welcome to see a commitment for increased investment, this does come off the back of years of underinvestment and undervaluing of, as I said, the care economy and social care in particular. So we believe that a lot more investment is going to be needed to make substantive impact for people's lives and to really reduce unpaid care that, as you mentioned, we've highlighted, often falls to women. We are undertaking some research, which we hope to be able to share with the committee in coming months, looking at what actual value we're talking about there in terms of how much more investment is needed, so that we can put some figures to that as well and share what we think is needed to really change the dynamics. Our care system just now relies on unpaid care, and we think there's a need to shift the dynamics so that we have a social care system that's there to support people and choice for those who want to care alongside it.
Thank you for that. I have no further questions in this area. Thanks.
Thanks for that, Pam. Can I actually ask you to go on to the next theme, because you're up on my list as coming in on human rights and equalities budget and in a crisis. If you could kick us off with that, thanks.
Absolutely. Thank you. Thanks, Convener. I was wondering whether either of you have been able to analyse the recent £53 million of cuts removed from employability support that was announced by the DFM, Deputy First Minister. And do you believe that those cuts could represent a retrogression? Do you have any concerns around that?
Yeah,
I'm happy
Sarah.
To come in. As was mentioned in an earlier answer as well, we haven't had a chance to do any further analysis on those cuts, but I think the key concern is that there hasn't been any information about the analysis that's been conducted by government in making that choice. For cutting the employability costs. We would really welcome seeing that analysis from government, and do believe that in any budget decisions there should be transparency and accountability. And we've, across kind of all different budget documents, we would like to see the equality impact assessments that have gone into making the decision. We would be concerned that particular groups of people will be impacted by the cut in employability, who find it particularly difficult to be in the labour market, and this will include groups of women, including single parents, disabled people, and carers as well. So the concern would be that the decision to make that cut, because the focus was on wages, is that there is a group of people for whom those wages may not be reaching as well, and we need to see more analysis to understand how they'll be affected.
I can see that Alison would like to come in as well on that. Thank you.
Yeah, I think in addition to who doesn't benefit from that particular cut, I would like to add the concern that the child poverty strategy, which is to help, helping to prevent poverty, not just alleviate it. And getting or supporting more parents back into employment and having more people contributing to the tax base is part of supporting people in the prevention of poverty. I think, I mean, we saw Audit Scotland's report this morning on child poverty and the fact that absolute poverty for children is almost one in four, which is a shocking state of affairs. And this was a figure prior to the pandemic and prior to the current cost of living. And we've got targets of reducing absolute poverty to 18% by the next budgetary cycle, and it's currently at 23%. So I think the strategy is perhaps skewing in removing employability or a focus on employability. We're skewing towards lifting people out of poverty, which, whilst important, is not helping to tackle the structural issues that are creating poverty in the first place, and supporting people out of poverty, if that makes sense. So removing that employability support is removing a poverty prevention lever. And I think that we're the social security focus, we're putting inviting a higher burden on the Scottish Government through social security payments, which are not covered by the Barnett formula, whilst possibly ensuring less taxes coming in because we're not focusing on helping people into employment. I think what a human rights assessment would necessitate is an exploration of where there is funding that could be diverted away from other areas that aren't essential to not have made that cut. But as said earlier, and as Sarah said as well, we need more information to make that assessment.
Thank you. And that's definitely came across in what you've said, and also, in fact, I think, in the Audit Scotland report. My last question in this area is just to simply ask, what engagement did you have with the government in June in the spending review, and also again with the DfM and their announcements last week?
Alison?
I would say that in terms of the spending review, with a very small team and massively under capacity, we didn't have time to individually respond, but I responded through my involvement with the Equality Budget Advisory Group. It wasn't a brilliant process. We didn't have a great engagement. I don't think we've done a lot of really good work with EBAG over the last few years, where there's been a lot of recognition from government about the needs to improve, for example, fiscal transparency and participation with the budget process. And we're waiting for their responses to recommendations that we made in July last year, which are due soon. And there's been a lot of recognition from government that these are the right things that they need to be doing. But let's get through the resource spending review and then we'll think about it, instead of for the first review in 10 years actually applying some of that. So it was a disappointing review. It didn't really connect with, the words human rights were mentioned once, and it wasn't in relation to the new legislation that is forthcoming in this parliament. We're about to implement and incorporate human rights treaties, one of the biggest changes since devolution in the human rights landscape in Scotland. And that's going to take significant resource in terms of capacity building with public bodies to ensure that there is implementation of this legislation. And that didn't feature at all. And this is a spending review for the next, till the end of Parliament, so it should have featured in there. So it was disappointing from our perspective.
Thank you. Do you have anything to add to that, Sarah? Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Rosie.
Just echoing the perspective, as we're also members of the Equality Budget Advisory Group, so was involved in those conversations, but echoing what Alison said in regards to them, we also contributed to the formal consultation around the resource spending review framework at the end of last year, beginning of this year. But beyond that sort of formal process, there wasn't any further engagement around the midterm announcements that were made a couple of weeks ago.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for that, Sarah. I'll now turn to our next theme, which is round about changes to the budget process. And I'm going to bring in my colleague Natalie Dawn to kick us off on that, and she joins us remotely. Over to yourself, Natalie, and then we'll go to Faisal Chowdhury after that. Natalie.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning to the panel. Yeah, moving on to the budget process itself. There's a lot more budget information published now. So we've talked briefly this morning. You've got Scottish Fiscal Commission forecast, reports and benefit updating, the medium-term financial strategy, fiscal framework outturn report, and the Equality and Fairer Scotland statement. And Sarah, I believe in your submission that you make some reference to this. So I'm just wanting to ask both of you what extent you feel that this information has improved the budget process. And where is there still room for improvement? Sorry, I'll go to Sarah first. Sorry, I referenced you specifically.
I think it's the more information we have, the better, basically. So it is an improvement to see more publications, but we still feel we're probably only like getting to halfway there in what we'd like to see. And I'll probably focus my answer particularly around the equality analysis dimensions and documents that we'd be keen to see on that, and that would feed into the Equality and Fairer Scotland budget statement. And as I was mentioning in one of the earlier answers, I think being able to have transparency and accountability around how decisions are made are key, and seeing the Equality and Budget Fairer Scotland statement as a process rather than an end output, but as a process to bring together the analysis that should be taking place as part of the decision-making process from start to finish around the budget and other policy considerations is really important within that. And we'd like to see within that a lot more access to information, particularly the equality impact assessments that are taking place around the decisions. There has been commitment within the resource spending review that they will be published from this budget onwards, and we really welcome seeing that and really hope to see that in the next budget. But I guess a little bit concerned because in the announcements a couple of weeks ago, there wasn't that information provided either. So we're hoping to see changes coming through in this budget that provides the information around that equality analysis. And I think that's really important that's coming through in each of the stages. Like it would have been, as Alison said, it would have been really great to see in the resource spending review, because that will then feed into each ongoing budget process and means it's a cumulative process rather than something that is seen each time to be starting from scratch, but it can be a cumulative process that develops and the understanding develops around it as well.
Thanks, Sarah, that's very helpful. Dr. Hosey, do you have anything to add to that?
Yeah, this is one of my favourite topics. Data. It's difficult to measure the impact on the budget process so far of these particular documents because they've just been so recently. It's difficult to make that assessment. But you know, they are positive steps, and it is encouraging that the government has listened to a lot of what EBAG and the Commission has been saying over the last few years about the need to produce more data. But the piece of work that we did a few years ago reviewing the Open Budget Survey, which is a global indicator of fiscal transparency, participation and accountability in the budget process. Scotland as a subnational can't be involved in it. It's the UK that is assessed, but they helped us to follow their very strict methodology to review Scotland against the global criteria. It showed that Scotland doesn't and still doesn't make available, whether they actually do it internally or not, they're not publicly available, four of the key eight internationally recommended documents for fiscal transparency. So we're missing on a regular citizens' budget that is made prior to the budgetary decision, so to enable people to make or to participate in decisions before decisions are decided, in-year and mid-year reporting, and also a pre-budget statement. Now, we have the programme for government, so to a degree it's not as a great concern about the pre-budget statement, but the other three are. And this is internationally recognised best practice in documentation for fiscal transparency. So we would like to see the government commit to doing their own review of the Open Budget Survey every couple of years, comparing themselves internationally to see where we stand in relation to our fiscal transparency. One of the things that, like, level four data is great, and it's really good to have that information, but we only can ever see on a year-on-year what the changes are. And we tried as part of a project a few years ago to look at the budget across a parliamentary cycle, so across a 4 or 5 year cycle. And all we could ever find was year to year. So we literally had to do lots of manual manipulation of all of these massive Excel sheets trying to put together where money which had moved because portfolios had changed, because committees had changed, and trying to actually match up spend in year one to year five. For more than half the budget, we couldn't do it. So being able to follow a budget process through a parliamentary cycle to look at what impact those decisions have had is impossible. So that's one of the areas that we would like to seize, time trend data. And also things that when you look at the data that's available, the real change versus cash change, it's important, obviously, especially now in relation to inflation, that we understand what the actual change in resources available to people are in real terms. And on this year on year, you get often, if there's no change, it's a flat line. But no change from one year to another, no change over 5 years, every year, is a massive change. So that there's things that we can't easily see in terms of the way that the data is currently presented. And also what often matters most is what's actually spent. You know, has the government spent the allocated funds that if it's not, it hasn't made maximum available use of its resources. We need to know whether the government has spent what it said it's going to spend things on in the coming year. If the allocated funds haven't been spent, how have they been reallocated? And was the reallocation process transparent, participative and accountable? And for this analysis to be possible, we need to be able to easily access and track data on unspent funds in a government's budget. And that's where your in-year and mid-year reports that we don't have access to are important. So I think that's probably enough for me on data, but that is an area where we understand that the government's Scottish Exchequer project of fiscal transparency, you know, it's a big 5-year project. We welcome that. But at the moment, it's still very difficult to make good budget analysis.
Thanks very much, both of you, for your answers. That is really helpful. There was a lot in there. And I think it kind of leads on to my next question as well. We've talked briefly again this morning about sort of maximising budget resources and looking at sort of different or alternative options for taxation and things like that. And again, sorry, Dr. Hosey, I know the SHRC recommended zero-based budgeting. Can you describe the scale of such an exercise and how that would take account of fixed costs within the Scottish budget, such as public sector pay and social security? I'll go to, again, Dr. Hosey first, and I'll bring you in, Sarah, after, if you've anything to add. Thank you.
Sure. A zero-based budgeting exercise, I suppose, by its very nature, would require taking into account the whole budget process and would likely take several years to conduct that kind of process due to the amount of evidence on process and procedure that's required. The idea stems from the fact that the Scottish Government have had in place now the same budget cycle structure for the past 25 years and leaving it to no longer reflect, I think, the growing needs of Scottish society. Structural issues such as yearly budget cycles, insufficient input of data and evidence in budgetary decisions, a lack of cumulative impact reports, for example, they all give rise to the need for, I think, a new modern approach to budgeting, both at the national and the local level. But this isn't to say that some of the practice and areas of spend, including what we know will remain as fixed costs within a budget, can't, you know, it's not to say that they can't be maintained. At the heart, a zero-based budgeting exercise would dictate that we need to pull apart the current process, reassess what elements currently work well and serve to fulfil Scotland's, you know, published national outcomes, and what within that process acts as a barrier to further fulfilment. So this kind of zero-based exercise would, I think it could be really highly impactful, but it would require a lot of time and sufficient analysis of the current budget cycle to take place. And for this reason, it could happen. It would need to happen alongside what is already in place and changes made incrementally. This would minimise disruption caused whilst allowing a kind of wider, holistic, more structural view to be taken, matching up to Scotland's future interests and needs within the new budgetary process. It requires almost going back to the drawing board, so that the scale is big, and I'm not denying that. It's probably, it needs to be a kind of 3 to 5 year project that you're actually looking at assessing what parts of the government budget fulfills our national outcomes, what parts of the process act as barriers. But then the idea would be that you run your current budget process at the same time and then slowly, incrementally make those changes. And as I said, it doesn't mean that you throw out, you know, everything like fixed costs. You've got to stay pay awards. They stay the same. There are elements of what you're going to just have to say, yeah, that works and we've got that in the right way. But without taking a step back and looking at the concept, we're not going to get anywhere new. We've been tinkering around with budget changes. But I think that there is a need to take a wholesale look at what we do, find out what works, what doesn't work, and try to think about how we could do this better.
Thank you. Thanks. I'll bring Sarah in. Sorry, thanks.
I've not too much more to add to this one, but maybe just to highlight, as part of the EBAD recommendations around building greater equalities and human rights into the budget process, a key element of that was leadership and support for these kind of mechanisms. So in order to start undertaking a process, like Alison has just outlined, it really it needs to have strong backing to be able to undertake it and to commit the time and build the capacity of those across the board who would be working on it and to take on the variety of issues that it would be looking at.
All right, thank you. My last question has actually been answered in the previous question, so I will pass back to the convener. Thank you.
Thanks for that, Natalie. We'll now move over to Faisal Chowdhury for some questions on this area. Faisal.
Thank you very much, convener. Good morning, panel. I think I'm going to put Dr. Hosey on spotlight again. One thing this committee has heard again and again, particularly when discussing matters of equality, is that there is not enough data or data is not collected. How much progress has been made in improving data sources on equalities?
He could put me on the spot, but it's probably Sarah that's best placed to answer in relation to data. It's an area where, from a rights perspective, to really understand who are the most marginalised, who are the most in need, we don't regularly have the level of data available to us. I think the coronavirus times showed us very quickly massive inadequacies, for example, in relation to the minority ethnic groups and the lack of information that we had available to us to be able to make quick decisions. Some of the focus in the SPICE briefing today talked about the necessity to make quick decisions and the problems that can create if you don't have already a good understanding through available data of what the current situations are to enable you to make those quick decisions. I will pass over to Sarah, though I think she knows more on this one than I do.
Thank you.
Thank you. Just building off what Alison said, I think there is some progress in some core bits of data, but what is really lacking is getting a full kind of intersectional look to be able to do more detailed analysis. So we can see some progress around getting some sex disaggregated data, and there has been a team within the Scottish Government who were looking at distributional analysis, and within their work they were able to pull out that they could do that kind of analysis, looking at the sectors of age and sex together, and looking at potentially age, sex and disability. But they said to look further, what didn't look to be feasible was to look at religion, ethnicity, and then into other protected characteristics. So more needs to be done to get the fuller picture for people. And it, as Alison has said, it's particularly important in these times of crisis, which we seem to be going through for years now, moving from COVID into the rising cost of living, because it's similarly marginalised groups that are being most hardest impacted by the crises, and we don't have enough data on these groups. So particularly to have the data on ethnic minority women or disabled women who might be most marginalised by the impacts of the rising cost of living, and were also hardest hit by COVID. I'd also just add, on top of needing the data, which is crucial, we need to then make sure it's used correctly and that the data goes on to be analysed fully. I have seen examples within equality impact assessments where there has been data on the point that's being considered, for example, workforce data. But that data hasn't been used for the next step of analysis. So there's some recognised statistics. I'm referring to an impact assessment that was published alongside the National Care Service Bill. So there was workforce data there, but the next step of analysis, we didn't feel carried that data into what was needed for the impact assessment, because it was recognised that the social workforce was a vast majority of women in the workforce, but the analysis led to saying there would be no one with protected characteristics impacted, because everyone would be impacted the same. But the fact that the majority of the workforce is women means that any changes are going to have a gendered impact. So it's both getting the data and also building the capacity around that analysis is crucial to make sure the data is appropriately used.
Thank you very much. I don't have any other question on this.
Thanks very much for the question, Faisal, and thanks for the answers so far. I think everybody on this committee recognises that the mainstreaming of equality is actually using that data, but then applying it once decisions are made is something that we're continually hearing about, and everybody knows that I will talk about gendered and disaggregated data until the cows come home and the need for it, and how we apply that in an intersectional way as well. I'm going to move on to questions around about council tax now, and to take us through that theme, I'll turn to my colleague Paul McLennan, please. Paul.
I think it was just more mainly on tax, I think, generally on tax policy. Alison, you touched on this and the importance of tax policy before, and just quoting you in terms of that, you said obviously the Scottish Government's focus should be more effectively spent on seeking to raise revenue rather than believing closing the funding gap through efficiency. And it's really just to try and touch a wee bit more on that one. I think we're obviously facing the position going into this budget. We're facing £1.7 billion almost cut in the budget because of inflation, which we've no control over. So obviously raising taxation is important in that. And I think you obviously mentioned as well, Sarah, around about obviously the impact of what you've said. There's a need to embed human rights and equality as overarching priority for Scotland's public spending and revenue-raising decisions. And I'm keen to touch on any specific issues in and about the issues you talked about for women, obviously. But I'll roll these questions all into one, is what principles should underline tax policies? What kind of impact analysis would you expect to accompany the tax policy? And are there any specific proposals you'd like to see in regards to tax for the 2023-24 budget? Alison, I'll probably start with yourself.
I think, as I said before, that when we responded to the consultation on the draft framework for tax, we agreed with the principles that were there. They weren't phrased from a rights-based perspective, but they were grounded in the government's rights obligations regarding participation in the maximisation of available resources, fairness, proportionality to pay. But I felt that we could have had that explicit reference to maximising available resources. It is a current obligation because through the International Convention on Economic and Social and Cultural Rights, we are signed up to through the UK. This is one of the treaties that's is going to be incorporated through the new Scottish Human Rights legislation. Within that, there is an obligation to maximise available resources. So I think we don't immediately look to where could we raise additional resources. I think the government hides behind the limitations that do exist, the genuine limitations in relation to the devolved context, but I think we could be more politically bold. So I think we need to challenge the government to say, have you looked at every possible available option before you think about cuts? Tax revenues are the main source of income for governments to facilitate the execution of their legal obligations to protect, respect and fulfil human rights. And so taxation policy plays a key role in the progressive realisation of rights. In order to maximise available resources, the government has to start by, you know, by asking in every budget, has every effort been made to maximise our budget, rather than just accepting, you know, that total. They have to ask, have all taxation options been looked at? Further questions, you know, are all the government's current or proposed tax options progressive? So once you've made the decision to look at different options, where are the resources generated from? Is it done fairly? Are particular groups impacted differently in addition to what has been done to tackle tax evasion and tax avoidance? And that's a favourite hobby horse of mine. I know that, again, it's HMRC that is responsible for compliance issues around tax evasion. But when we did our project a few years ago, we looked at trying to extrapolate from UK data the approximate tax evasion cost to the Scottish budget. And it was between £3 and £7 billion. That's a staggering amount of money. And it dwarfs the amount of money that we're losing through inflation just now. At the UK level, it's like £30 to £70 billion. So I think if we can have a discussion, more discussions with HMRC about the service level agreement that they have around compliance issues in Scotland, what can be done? It's of benefit to the UK budget as well as to ours. I think there are good examples of work that's been done in other countries, in Spain in particular, to look at reducing the black market and the impact that has on available taxation coming in, and how that countered against the amount that they were cutting through their austerity budgets. So there's work there, and I think that's important work to look at, as well as what I mentioned earlier around looking at local taxation, looking at how we tax income versus how we tax wealth, looking at council tax. We need to do something about council tax. The analysis you mentioned, there's some good guidance from the former UN independent expert on foreign debt and human rights, never say his name right, Juan Pablo Bohuslavsky, who produced guiding principles for human rights impact assessments for economic reforms, and I can send that information into the committee. The aim of these guiding principles is to provide effective and practical guidance and tools for assessing economic reform policies and on the basis of human rights standards. So there's some really, really good concrete advice there about how to undertake that kind of process and the sorts of analysis that would be helpful in this particular situation.
Thanks, Alison. I just want to pick up one of the things that you said. You mentioned obviously about the genuine limitations of the devolved settlement, and you obviously one prime example you gave was obviously HMRC. We have no powers in Scotland to deal with that, this tax evasion, as you said, £3 to £7 billion. There's discussions we had from the Scottish Fiscal Commission and the Cabinet Secretary Kate Forbes talking about the fiscal framework and then about flexibility for that. And one of the things we've, I suppose, argued for and debated here was around about having the abilities to borrow more within that fiscal framework. And I know there's discussions ongoing at the moment. I don't know if you're aware of these, but is there anything within the fiscal framework and given the flexibility to the Scottish Parliament within the devolved settlement that you think would be useful, specifically around about the approach that we're talking about in the budget, around about, obviously, social security?
Just in general terms, it's the next one. With the number of pre-budget scrutinies that we've been looking at, we're now moving on to the framework, so that's my job for next week. But I think the key issues around how the rest of the world has been dealing with the cost of living crisis and recovering from the pandemic, they've all been using borrowing powers, and it is a significant limitation. So I think it's a legitimate ask of the government in the reassessment of the fiscal framework that borrowing powers is something that needs to be significantly improved.
Yeah, Alison, thank you for that. Sarah, just to yourself, just on the same points, just around about what we talked about before, as I said, around about the principles, the impact analysis, and obviously any specific proposals, and obviously looking at, in particular in terms, obviously, how that impacts on women.
Yeah, well, I think, as many of you know, as an organisation, Scottish Women's Budget Group has seeking gender equality through the process of gender budget analysis. And that is both analysis of public spending, but also revenue raising, and bringing that analysis into any proposals and an intersectional gender analysis into any proposals, so around tax. So looking for a gender and distributional analysis on any proposed changes to tax would be needed so that we could consider the different impacts of the changes on women and men, on those on low incomes, on those on across various ages, for example. And then this analysis would be key to sort of developing the policies that would work towards equality through the tax system as well. And they need to be, as we've kind of said on other points around public spending, established within the decision-making process so that they are kind of an ongoing part of the process, both at the design stage, but also at implementation and then at review to see if potential assumptions that were made within the impact assessment process are borne out, or if there was unexpected changes that require some kind of fixes to them. So for those, it's necessary to have the data we were talking about in the previous answer, but also do that kind of detailed analysis about where it goes. And just to kind of echo the points that were being made, I've made a little bit earlier as well, there's progress around income tax, but looking at council tax as a regressive space is a really important one. The Office of National Statistics demonstrates that households in the bottom quintile pay 4.6% of their income on council tax, whereas those in the top quintile pay 1.4%. So looking at the different distributions and reviewing what can be done at a local tax base. And then also, potentially longer term, looking at how tax can also be used as an action to tackle things like the climate emergency and where there might be powers for progressive carbon taxes, for example, that could be designed to limit pollution and be part of a kind of what we would call for would be a feminist just transition. On the point around borrowing powers in the fiscal framework, just to add to that to date the borrowing powers within the fiscal framework, they're quite limited, and they're also limited to capital expenditure primarily. And should there be changes, it would be key for us that wherever those powers lie, that the form of the gender intersectional analysis comes into how they're used. But we would be keen to see powers that allow borrowing for social infrastructure as well as physical infrastructure, and by that meaning elements such as the care economy and into care services as part of vital social infrastructure and supporting jobs within social infrastructure. And just to kind of second the points that Alison was making around tax evasion and being able to avoid as much loss as possible within the system.
Yeah. Thank you very much. Thanks, Chair.
Thank you very much for that. We'll now move to our last theme for this panel this morning, which is round about the Equality and Fairer Scotland budget statement. And to start us with that, I'm going to hand over to my colleague Jeremy Balfour and then over to Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, panel. I found this very interesting, and it's kind of led to two questions for me in regard to your answers so far. And I wonder if I could start with Dr. Hosey, but in regard to my first question. And that is in regard to any human rights-based budgeting must, because it's a fixed budget, mean that somebody loses out. So if I give more money to those with disability, am I taking money away from, say, people from gender issues? I'm just wondering, how do you balance that in practice? How are you looking simply for that information to see how we came to the decisions? Or how do you not end up always discriminating against somebody because of the way you set your budget?
It's a good question. I mean, it comes to the heart of why do you do human rights budgeting? It's not a silver bullet. It doesn't cure everything. But it's about putting in place slightly better systems and processes so that we can understand that what we are doing, or at least predict to a degree, the impact, potential impact of the budgetary decisions that we are taking, that they are grounded in the obligations. The government has got obligations in relation to economic, social and cultural rights and the realisation, fulfilment of those rights. We have what's called a minimum course, a minimum level of those rights that we are meant to fulfil. So from a rights perspective, that's where I would start. I would look at the evidence that exists. Are we meeting that minimum level? And the budget, whatever resources we have, whatever crises we are in or times of good times, we must meet that minimum level. But it's a floor, not a ceiling. And so we are then obliged to look at how we can continually improve, how our services continually improve, how our outcomes can continually improve. And part of the budgeting process over time is to see those improvements. But we must always make sure that the most marginalised and the minimum core are satisfied and that we focus on the most vulnerable. So that it provides a process through which to make transparent, fair, participative decisions. And when you make decisions within that type of structure, you are looking at all of the available evidence. You're looking at where the need is greatest and where rights need to be respected. And you where priorities have to be made, it makes those decisions. They might still not be easy decisions, but it makes them transparent. So, yes, there will always be winners and losers in a budget, but it's based on your obligations. It's based on what you need to be doing rather than on arbitrary decisions. We don't have necessarily the evidence required to make those kind of decisions right now, to take a rights-based approach to the budget. But this is something that, as we've talked about in a lot of the evidence today, that we want to see improving over time.
Thank you for that. And that kind of leads me on nicely to my second question. I suppose, firstly, you could be listening to this evidence today and think, well, that's all very good, and it's a paper exercise. But what difference does it make to a disabled person in Inverness? Or what difference does it make to somebody from an ethnic minority in Dumfries? So I wonder if you could just give me a wee bit more on how this actually makes a difference to the average person. And secondly, this is asking you to speculate. As if it's intended by Scottish Government, we implement these human rights legislation into Scots law, does it mean in future individuals could then challenge the budget in court if they haven't had their quality properly defined? And do you see this ending up possibly with legal cases against the Scottish budget?
I'll take the first question around, you know, the impact. I saw in the Spice briefing that how can we ensure impact assessments are more than just a paper exercise? And I think the tone of the question is it's fair enough. You know, impact assessments, it's a fair criticism to table at things like equality impact assessments and rights impact assessments and what difference does it make to people on the ground. But I think it comes down to education awareness raising, culture change within decision making, and ensuring that the tools are used effectively and how those conducting them do them. And so it's about internal awareness raising throughout Parliament, throughout government, throughout the different public bodies that are going to be conducting these kind of assessments. And it's not just saying to public authorities, you know, with the new children's rights wellbeing impact assessments, for example, go away, off you go and do that without any training or without any capacity building around it. Are we ever going to ensure that every impact assessment carried out is done perfectly? No. But can we put in place the best kind of systems and training available to ensure, you know, that what we're doing, if we're doing everything we can to try and reach that goal? Yes. But it's like this is about culture change. So, again, something that we should be raising much more of is what is the awareness of how to conduct impact assessments within government, within Parliament? Who on this committee would feel comfortable to go away just now and do an equality and human rights impact assessment? I wouldn't. I would want more training, and I work in human rights. You know, it's important that we have a good understanding of how to undertake these kinds of processes to have impact for people. And until it's understood that human rights and equalities impact of policy decisions and spend are critical to informing the decisions we take, rather than as a siloed process that we have to do and we can just do after the decisions are already made, the perception of impact assessments as paper tick box exercises won't change. I think when it can be understood that understanding the potential impact before decisions are made makes better decisions. And this is when we'll be able to say that, you know, impact assessments are more than paper exercises. If they're valued, that is the culture change we need to see. and good impact assessments engage with people with lived experience. They involve people whose decisions are going to affect them, and therefore better decisions are made. I've now completely forgotten what your second question was.
I was asking you to speculate into the future about whether this could then lead to legal cases against budgets.
Yeah, I mean, I think one of the most distinctive features of a human rights-based approach to poverty reduction, for example, is that it's based on the norms and values set out in international law. The rights and obligations demand accountability. So when a government talks about rights, unless it's supported by a system of accountability, they're no more than window dressing. And currently, this is where the gap is in Scotland between international and domestic legal protections. There's this accountability gap. So with the new legislation coming in, this will bring with it, hopefully, access to justice. So it's not just about court cases, though. So the judicial remedies need to be there. But there's also quasi-judicial processes through ombudsmans. There's administrative routes through the preparation, publication and scrutiny of impact assessments. And there's political routes through parliamentary scrutiny, parliamentary processes. So the judicial route will be one aspect of access to justice. And yes, that theoretically, that is one of the important aspects of having the domestic protections, is that there is a legal backstop. But it doesn't mean that we want everything to end up in court. It's about improving the culture, changing the culture, improving the structures and processes so that that's not where we end up, but that we end up with a budget that does take human rights inequalities into consideration in its development.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for that. And now over to Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you, Convener. My question will be, how effective are impact assessment as an exercise? How can we better ensure that they are taken seriously and not seen as just another hoop to jump through?
Will I start on that one? I think building on what Alison has said, it's about seeing them as integral to the budget decision-making process rather than something that you do at the end. I think that's where a lot of challenges can be made, that they're ineffective, is when they're done retrofitted to a decision that's already been made. But if they are used throughout the decision-making process, and the information that is brought in, the data that's brought in, and where there's not data, if it's possible to go to either civil society organisations or work on engagement directly with people with lived experience around the issue, then they become much more effective. And that's why we really need to move into the process of using them in that way, so that they both inform decisions and can be used to review them as well. Because being done at the end of a process does, when a decision has already been made, does lessen the impact. It does it degrades the kind of whole process, really, because it's not taking the process as a serious part of the decision making, but it's seeing it as just an add-on. And I think that means, you know, often existing structural inequalities become entrenched because it's not looking at how does this policy, for example, the decision to freeze train fares, how does this policy impact on men and women differently, on disabled people differently, who's using trains, and how does the input that's going into freezing train fares, does that make a difference to those who are using bus services, or is there going to be a similar kind of additional investment in those using bus services? Because we know that women and disabled people are more likely to use bus services as a form of public transport. So when they were making that decision, how was the different uses of public transport brought into it, so that we can consider who benefits most and if it's entrenching any existing inequalities?
Thank you very much for that. I'll now move on to a final question for the panel that I've got myself that we haven't picked up on yet. The National Performance Framework is a very high level, we know this, and its 81 indicators are generally statistical measures that indicate broad trends. And I'm wondering, what's the best way to use the NPF to inform scrutiny of this year's budget decisions? And even if you think about those budget decisions that will be taken as well as, you know, in this place, and local authorities and their partners, if you think about local improvement outcome plans, and if we think about community planning partnerships, how do we actually make sure that the NPF directs and informs those budgetary decisions at a much better level than currently is happening? And I'll start with Alison if I can.
I think the quick answer to that question of the best way to use the NPF to inform scrutiny of this year's budget decisions is actually link the NPF indicators to budgetary decisions. Currently, there is no connection between the NPF and the Scottish Budget. As far as measuring progress goes, we need to have a rethink, and now the NPF is being reviewed is a good time to think about this. What outcomes are we trying to achieve? What are we putting in place to achieve that? What resources are we putting in, and how do we generate those resources? That whole linkage, and also how the national outcomes link to the programme for government, all of that needs to be better linked to the actual budgetary decisions that are being made. Right now, in the ESBS, there are connections made in that portfolios talk about the national outcomes that are relevant to their area and the human rights that are relevant to their area, but there's no depth to the analysis. There's nothing further other than just mentioning that those areas are relevant to their portfolios. And it's because the two frameworks are not connected. So we need to connect budget decisions to the NPF outcomes.
That's a fantastic short answer. Thank you very much. Sarah, do you have anything to add to that?
No, not really anything to add to that. I think the national outcomes are supposed to be a demonstration of what we value as a society, and the budget should be looking at how it spends in a way on our values. So the connection is just vital, and just seconds the point that Alison made.
Thank you very much for that, and thank you both for coming along this morning and sharing your thoughts and your insight and giving us some evidence. It's been very helpful. I will now suspend briefly to allow the next panel of witnesses to change over. Thank you very much. Good morning and welcome back. I now welcome to the meeting our second panel. We've got Ed Fibus, who is the Policy and Parliamentary Officer for the Child Poverty Action Group, CPAG. And we have Morag Traynor, who is Deputy Chair of the Poverty and Inequality Commission. And we also have Paul Bradley, who is the Policy and Public Affairs Manager for the SCVO, the Scottish Council for Voluntary Organisations. Thank you very much for coming along this morning, and it was great to see you in the first session to hear the evidence we heard there as well. We're going to turn to our first theme, which is round about the impact of the cost of living on individuals and also on organisations. And to start us off on this, I'll turn to my colleague Emma Roddick, then to be followed by Pam Duncan-Glancy. Over to yourself, Emma. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. My first question is really for you, Paul, but either of you might want to jump in as well. I've been seeing across my region quite a lot of commercial businesses having to close their doors because of rising energy prices, and I wondered if you could tell us how badly this is affecting third sector organisations at the moment.
Yeah, of course. Just like businesses, voluntary organisations haven't been able to access a price cap for their energy, so that's been a big issue for organisations who are basically left exposed to the cost of energy just now. Clearly, we welcome the UK government's intervention that it announced a couple of weeks back, with more detail yesterday, and that will make some difference to voluntary organisations. And we now know through research from our third sector research tracker that rising costs are now the number one challenge for voluntary organisations in Scotland. And while that stretches across the board, so a range of different things like transport costs and suppliers and materials and rents and so on, the two big ones are where there's significant challenges around energy and around staffing costs as well. So I think now around 53% are reporting significant energy cost rises, whereas in the spring it was around 30-something percent, so there has been a significant increase. What's been quite interesting from the data we've been looking at is that those organisations that are struggling most with rising costs are also those organisations that are most likely to be seeing rising demand for their services, and also those organisations most likely to be unable to meet that rising demand. And not just the new demand, but also they're now saying that they're unable to deliver all of their planned work that they had originally kind of set out for the year. And in terms of what that means for individuals, well, you have organisations that people and communities are relying upon the most to support them through this crisis, and those organisations aren't able to provide the level of support that is needed. And then just another link in terms of the impact on organisations and how that kind of leads on to affecting individuals, that we have to remember that voluntary organisations employ over 135,000 people. So that's 5% of the Scottish workforce. That's quite a significant percentage. And we know that research recently published by Pro Bono Economics has shown that across the UK, the voluntary sector workforce is paid 7% less compared with other fields. And I think that was in 2019. And I think Bank of England data shows that that gap has widened again by a couple of percent. And people in the voluntary sector already, many were on low wages. So I think around 12.5%, it's estimated around 12.5% of roles in the voluntary sector are paid below the real living wage, which we've seen today has been increased. And those people already struggling to make ends meet. But now what you have is organisations unable to be able to support their staff properly in the way they would want to because of years of static funding, but also now they're seeing their funding massively devalued because of inflation or because of changing behaviours from the public as well, because everyone's in a cost of living crisis too. So that's how it's impacting voluntary organisations, and we're hopeful that the energy changes from the UK government will prevent things from getting a whole lot worse, but there needs to be a wider package of support that's made available to organisations as we kind of make our way through the kind of months ahead.
Thank you very much for that. Can I also just dig a little deeper into the issues around energy policy, because of course it is reserved. So essentially a lot of action here is simply asking the UK government to take action. One of the things the Scottish government has asked is for a price cap and freeze to be applied to businesses. Do you support that ask?
So I think what I would say about the price cap is that it isn't the kind of, someone said silver bullet earlier on, Hongi, that again, it's not the silver bullet that I think people think it is. If we look at the price cap and what that's meant for households, it hasn't had a huge impact on households being able to kind of weather the storm. And, you know, the prices that voluntary organisations are paying were already well above what households are paying, even in terms of kind of the current price cap that households are subjected to. But of course, anything that stops or prevents the significant daily changes and fluctuations upwards in the energy market is absolutely essential just now. Longer term, I think there's a general agreement that the cap is not fit for purpose for households, and it's not fit for purpose for businesses or for voluntary organisations. We need to look at we need to address energy completely. And also we need to look at other ways in which we can secure cheaper, greener energy for voluntary organisations which are across Scotland. And I know the Scottish Government and a member sitting around this table has worked with us recently to get some questions answered around the Scottish Government's procurement frameworks, which are accessible to members of the OSCA, the Office of the Scottish Charity Regulator, and members of SCVO. And there is a natural gas and energy framework there, and that helps to bulk buy energy at cheaper cost, and I believe it's greener energy too. But there's a lack of awareness around that. It isn't very well promoted. We weren't aware that SCVO members could access that until recently. And I think there's a lot more to do in terms of looking at how we use that power of bulk buying in the future to ensure that it's not just going to the public sector, but also voluntary organisations can access that, because predictability is the most important thing.
Thank you very much.
Ed wants to come in on that as well, Ed.
Just, I guess, on the first point about the impact on organisations and from a child poverty perspective, as Paul has said, that's the additional costs for organisations are facing means they can't do all the frontline work they need to do, and income maximisation is a key part of tackling child poverty, making sure people are getting their entitlements. The social security system is inadequate, but at least if you get, you need to get what you can get. And so the fear is that if they're having to spend their money on their energy bills, they're not going to be able to spend money on frontline advice services. There's not enough capacity in the advice service at the moment as it is, and this is going to add extreme pressure to that. And the other thing is organisations that are meant to be supporting families with a wide range of supports and challenges are having to focus on these individuals' immediate cash crisis, and so maybe having to change the emphasis of their work and not getting that longer-term support. We'll talk about employability, I'm sure, later. That families need to remain out of poverty because they're dealing with crises, so it's changing workload that organisations are facing as well.
And Morag, I think you would like to come in.
Yes, thank you. So we in the Poverty and Inequality Commission have been making visits to third sector organisations to see how the cost of living crisis has been affecting them and affecting the people they aim to help. And some of what they're reporting back to us is that they're seeing a change in the profile of the type of people needing to use their services, people who are in work, people who are on pensions, people who have never before come to a food bank or a food pantry are now accessing them. They're seeing hungry children more and increasingly, which is a new thing. There's a perfect storm ahead for them because all of this is coming on the back of the pandemic, where resources were already depleted, energy was depleted and finances depleted. So the crisis of the cost of living crisis is having a huge impact. They have people reporting that they are trying to use calor gas heaters and camping stoves to do cooking and heating in their homes, which is causing condensation but also is a massive fire risk. And that's before we are even entering a Scottish winter. So they're also seeing a huge increase in mental health crises among the people that are using services, which was already the case as a cause of the pandemic and isolation, and which has now been greatly exacerbated by the cost of living crisis. So that's some of the things that the organisations are trying to deal with and the people using their services, on top of the fact that they have no increase in their own funding, flat funding, no inflationary rises as a consequence of the current cost of living crisis. So they are struggling. They're struggling to retain volunteers. They're struggling to attract volunteers. The volunteers who, for example, were offering to drive and deliver packages and care supports to people can no longer afford the fuel to even be volunteers for the third sector organisations. So there's a lot of intricate interplay there of negative impacts and effects.
Thanks very much for that, Morag, and I think that that echoes what we've already heard in some of the previous evidence sessions into our inquiry on low income and debt. And we know that those issues that are already pre-existing are going to be exacerbated, but also newer people are going to be finding themselves in that situation. Now, before I hand over to Pam, we did hear from colleagues in the first session round about the fact that Scotland does have a fixed budget and trying to reprioritise spending, and submissions from the SCVO and from the Poverty and Inequality Commission. We did hear that there's a recognition that there needs to be more funding coming from the United Kingdom government on this. And I'm wondering, if that's something that, we need to actually see the cost of living crisis in the same light as the pandemic and actually have a response along those lines.
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. That's one of the points I would have made today and we made in our written submission, is that this crisis is of the same scale and potential effects as the pandemic itself, and it needs a similar level of response from the UK government.
Thank you.
Yes, Paul? I would, in terms of voluntary organisations and their ability to survive, this probably goes beyond the pandemic. I think about 50% of organisations back in December were reporting the cases around financial hardship from individuals, and now that level's at around 79% of organisations reporting that. But I think voluntary organisations themselves have their challenges in terms of the funding that they have and their ability to support organisations, support people. And I think that what we have is the cost of living crisis on its own is a huge challenge, and it feels almost impossible for some organisations to be able to kind of get through this without looking at kind of increasing the level of funding they receive and targeted support. But when you add this crisis on top of the pandemic and then austerity and organisations not receiving inflationary uplifts for the best part of 10 years, sometimes 13 years, you can see that this system that we have currently is just about getting by. And I think we use the term perfect storm a lot in the sector, and I understand that because there is just crisis after crisis, but I genuinely think that this is that moment, because organisations can't continue to plug the gap any longer. 60% of charities in Scotland have less than 6 months financial reserves. Now, that's a problem in terms of legal obligation, but I think government and public sector have been reliant on voluntary organisations for too long, for topping up public services in that way. And unfortunately, we're at a point now where those reserves have been devalued, and there's a question mark around whether they should be even used for that in the first place. But I think we are at a moment where there's huge challenges. But of course, we need to recognise that, as you say, the Scottish Government works from a fixed budget, and the UK Government has been too slow to act on this. We've been quite clear about that. It needs to have the same scale of response that we saw during the pandemic. Different type of response, but definitely of that level.
Yeah, and I think that there's several of us on the committee that come from the voluntary sector and really do understand the challenges that are there. So it's good to hear that highlighted this morning. I'll hand over to Pam Duncan-Glancy for some questions on this area as well. Thanks.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you to the panel so far for your answers, but also for the evidence you submitted in advance as well. And actually, just I'd like to take an opportunity to thank you for the work that you're doing, because of not just because of the work that you've always been doing in this area, but actually because of what the context and what you've just set out is pretty grim, actually. And so I know that doing that on a daily basis is going to be really, really hard. And listening to the stories of the people that you represent and provide services to must also be really, really hard. So thank you. I agree with much that's been said, of course, about the UK government and their paralysis, their inaction. They've not met the scale of the challenge and they absolutely need to do more. And I will reserve some of those comments for another moment. But for now, in terms of what we can do here in Scotland and in the Scottish Parliament and what the Scottish Government can do, on the issue of organisations. I know that the First Minister in June committed again at the gathering to multi-year funding for third sector organisations. So I wonder if, Paul, could you set out the sort of progress you've seen since the First Minister made that commitment?
Of course, it's always my favourite question to answer, because as you all know, SCB are consistently raising this as one of the issues that we would like to see tackled by the Scottish Government in their budget. And it's also, while there is that additional call for inflationary uplifts, it is something that actually isn't about incurring significant additional costs. It's about looking at kind of how we improve the funding system to ensure that we're reducing waste in the system, that we're reducing staff time that's spent on annual applications and monitoring and yeah, it's unbelievable. It's almost a kind of business in itself within government. And I always think that my brother's an accountant. And he always has to bill for every 15 minutes that he's working on a client's account. And I think that if we broke down people's time like that and actually looked at what they were doing around everything to do with annual funding arrangements, we'd soon see all the waste in the system. I think the general line has been recently that the Scottish Government's budget is annual from Westminster, so therefore voluntary organisations' budgets will need to be annual as well, and there's no real room to manoeuvre there. We were then told that the spending review would be the opportunity to address some of that, and I think that the Cabinet Secretary spoke in front of a committee, whether it's this one or the Equalities Committee, and raised that as the area in which we would expect to see some progress made. I don't think we saw any progress in the spending review on this, bar perhaps one fund relating to health, and that's not at the scale that we're looking for in terms of kind of systemic change. You're right that the First Minister committed again to ensuring that multi-year funding is delivered where possible, but that was a commitment that was also made, I believe, back in 2015 or 16 as well, and it's something that I raised in the kind of submission on the spending review. I am surprised, given the focus on multi-year funding, that no one has come and sat down with us in the sector to discuss why it isn't possible to do it, or understand from us what potential solutions there could be to kind of find a middle ground. Mm-hmm. I think that's the type of response that we would be wanting to see from government, rather than simply defending what they're already doing on multi-year funding or saying it's not possible. I think the voluntary sector and SCBO, we're pragmatic and we understand the challenges. It's very easy to criticise government, and we understand the challenges with the kind of arrangement of the budget they have and so on. But at the same time, our role is to, we can do both. We can recognise the challenges they face. At the same time, if we believe strongly about making a case for something, we will continue to do that. And that's what we're doing here with funding. I think it's useful for us to remind ourselves why we're calling for multi-year funding. It's about improving job security and reducing the number of redundancy notices in the sector. It's about predictability and being able to plan over longer term, being able to use that security to go and harness in resources from elsewhere, whether it's from the public or independent funders. And it's also about, as I said, cutting out the waste and bureaucracy that exists. So what I would expect to see is if multi-year funding is impossible to deliver, then where's the discussion that's taking place about how do we get to those kind of outcomes? And what's the middle ground? The one thing I would say is that the Scottish Government receives its annual budget from from Westminster. But I would assume that there are a number of people within the Scottish Government that are on permanent contracts and have job security. So if it's possible for Scottish Government staff, why is it not possible for staff who are also delivering public services elsewhere?
Thank you for that. Did you want to come in as well, Ed?
Just very briefly, one of the consequences of seeing all your funding, we're hearing more and more, getting more and more evidence of advice services not only struggling with funding, but struggling to recruit advisers because short-term funding means they can't take on someone and train them up because by the time that's done, the funding's over and they've left. So there's a lack of trained advisers in advice services, and funding plays a part in that.
Thank you. You're both really, really clear on that, actually, and thank you for that. And the points about, you know, sitting down and actually explaining it, I think, are something that the committee, I hope, can take forward, because that does seem like a sensible approach as opposed to a sort of nothing we can do about it, given the impact you've just described. Thank you. I have a further question on the impact of the cost of living on organisations, and I know that the government put about £1.2 million into additional funding into advice services, which I'm sure would have been welcomed. But can you set out whether or not that has sort of met the demand? I have to say, given what you've already said, I'm a bit sceptical about whether it has, but like, if it has, then excellent. If it hasn't, can you give us an idea of the scale of the difference here and what the impact that's going to be on the ability of services to continue?
So that's welcome, obviously, additional funding to the advice sector. The short answer is we don't know. It's hard to map the lack of service. We are hearing, for example, Glasgow and Greater Clyde NHS have just done some research around referral pathways, and what we call for in income maximisation is these warm referral pathways, not a phrase I particularly like, but so when someone presents at a service, they get a referral to an advisor who can give them their income maximisation and debt advice and other supports, and they are finding there isn't enough capacity at the end of that referral pathway, or there's really long waits, and then people aren't able to get the advice they need, and if you can't maximise your income, as I keep saying, the social security system is inadequate to lift everyone out of poverty, but at least you need to get your entitlements. So we are hearing evidence that there's a lack of capacity once these services are in place, and it's hard for funding for those services. What we don't know is how much additional funding is needed to meet that capacity, because I'm not aware of there being a research across Scotland that can pick that up. I guess, as has been mentioned, we're seeing an increasingly complex income maximisation process, partly because of an increasingly complex social security system. We've still got the full rollout of Universal Credit in Scotland. We've still got rollout of the Scottish benefits. We've got new benefits. But we're also seeing a huge amount of people that are accessing the system for the first time due to the cost of living crisis. And so that needs trained, experienced advisers, and that needs investment in the advice sector, not only to provide the advice, but also to train the advisers.
It goes beyond advice as well. If I look at our third sector research tracker, which is representative of kind of the voluntary sector as a whole, 88% of voluntary organisations are reporting worsening emerging needs in their communities. So that's all types of voluntary organisations in Scotland. And we know from our own funds that we manage, so we manage some funds that are kind of given to us for the Scottish Government to manage. One fund we received, both of these funds, while the funding goes to voluntary organisations, it's about supporting individuals, so it goes to individuals via voluntary organisations. One fund just recently closed and had 206 applications, and we can only fund 41 of those. And the other fund has just closed with 214 applications, totaling 2.1 million. And that's for a funding pot of 465,000. And within those 214, probably fund around 30 to 40 of those. So that's just some examples from our own funds that we manage. But I wouldn't be surprised if across the board, that is the type of scale demand that we're seeing. And I think that the challenge just now is that there's a discussion or a decision to be made about whether or not you're funding new things and new needs that are emerging, or whether you're channeling funding to the organisations and the projects that are already there that are struggling to stay afloat because they haven't got enough money to keep it going, and they're also seeing rising demand. And you are seeing some independent funders saying, we're not going to fund new stuff, but what we are going to do is we're going to put on a 10% annual uplift, and we're going to cover some of your core costs as well, which is extremely welcome. That's the type of thing that we want to see, and we'd like to see more of that from government. But at the same time, that's going to have an impact on other organisations that are looking to try and access funding for the first time or from different sources. And it's back to that question or discussion we were having in the early session about winners and losers. And it's a difficult one and difficult decisions to be made, whether it's about the employability thing and wages and so on. There is no easy answer, but we are in a challenging situation.
Do you have a sense of what you would do in the balance of, you maybe don't, and it's a really difficult question, but in the balance of give enough funding to continue what is already being done and the uplift, or start funding new projects, and how would you even begin to, how could we as a committee and government begin to try and address that?
Yeah, I don't want to get in trouble and come up with policy off the hoof, but what I would say is, it is unsustainable to underfund services and underpay workers. So if you haven't got the money there to do that, then that is a real issue. And in an ideal world, we would be getting funding out to lots of different organisations and we would be doing that at an adequate level. But Alison, I think, mentioned in the previous session, it was on a slightly different focus, but she mentioned minimum core and getting that right. And you know, if we aren't getting that right and we aren't funding that to the level that's needed, then we don't have a vibrant sector that is able to go out and harness new opportunities from independent funders, from the public sector, from businesses as well. We're talking about maximising the spending envelope on public services. It's not just about taxation, it's about using other channels to be able to draw in additional resource, which we have very little discussion about at all, and the role the sector plays in that. So I think, it's just a... And that's why the discussion around things like the employability versus money versus the wage increases is, I think it's really easy to sit here and criticise it. And, SCBO have been involved in employability for many years, and we still are to a certain extent. But at the same time, we need to ensure that people are being paid the right amount of money to ensure they don't slip into poverty. But I would really just echo the points that Alison made in the last session about, I am not able to determine whether or not the best decision was made, in my opinion, because there is no data. There is no information around how that decision was made. And so it's very hard to comment on something like that.
Thank you. I appreciate that. Thank you. I have no further questions at this point.
Thank you very much for those answers. I'll hand over to Faisal Chowdhury for a question at the moment.
Thank you, Convener. The committee has been made aware of the impact of the cost of living crisis for single parent families. Is there enough concern about the vulnerability of this group to poverty, including child poverty?
Will we ask Ed that?
I mean, the OPFS report that was published today is stark reading, to say the least. Testimony from parents, and one that particularly jumped out is, I feel I'm failing my children because I haven't got enough resources to support them. And this is... we have to, taking a step back, Scotland is one of the richest countries in the world, yet we have child poverty levels at this rate, and particularly for lone parents, one of the groups that are far higher in child poverty. So we're aware of that. And we know the causes of child poverty, two of the main causes are inadequate social security and inadequate income from wages. And we need continued investment in both of those areas to lift these families out of poverty. The £25 Scottish child payment that's lone parents will be receiving from November 14th is incredibly welcome and will make a real difference to many families. But it's not sufficient. It's not enough. It needs to keep its real terms value. So we, you know, we've got inflation at 10%, possibly higher, and low-income families. A very interesting presentation from Fraser Valander Institute yesterday that breaks down the rates of inflation for the different levels of income, and the lowest 10% have far higher rates of inflation than others. And so we need an above inflation raise in the Scottish child payment in April when the next uprating is due to ensure that it keeps its value and keeps supporting these. We also have to make sure that some of the penalties that the priority groups face in the current welfare system are fixed. So a lot of lone parents are also young parents. And young parents are hit by this under 25 penalty in universal credit. They just get less money for being under 25, yet their energy bills are exactly the same. Two-child limit. Larger families, we know, are much more likely to be in poverty because the UK welfare system caps the amount of support that you can get to only two children. So, of course, that's going to drive larger families into poverty. Both of these need to be need to be got rid of at Westminster, but in the meantime, the Scottish Government, if they're to meet their child poverty targets, need to mitigate the impact of these in Scotland. Lone parents face particular issues as well. Again, changes to the social security system over the last 10 years have meant that lone parents are particularly hard hit. There's talk today at a UK level of increasing conditionality again for parents. Lone parents face conditionality from the age their child was one. When I started doing welfare rights few years ago now, lone parents weren't expected to be looking for work until they were 12. There was employability services to support them looking for work, but it was accepted that you have to look after your child. And when you haven't got the employability services and the childcare available, yet you've got a welfare system that penalises lone parents for not finding jobs, which they can't take in because of the barriers they face to employment. So a very welcome report from OPFS highlights the issues that families face, and they are a key group. But if the Scottish Government and Scotland as a whole is to meet its child poverty targets, need to get that support, and that is additional investment in Social Security, as I said, and that support. I'm sure we'll come on to employability more later. That additional support to support them into higher paid jobs.
Thank you very much for that. And just to pick up on a little point with regards to, seeing lone parents specifically penalised within the DWP system, there was worrying announcements yesterday around about those that are in 10, 12, 13, 14-hour contracts being pushed into having to increase their hours or face penalties. Is that a worrying announcement for yourselves and CPAG?
We know that we have evidence that strict conditionality doesn't help people find better jobs and better paid jobs and more hours. And in fact, poverty in and of itself is a barrier to people being employed. So when you have a lone parent who's working a few hours, who's still in poverty, remember 60% of families who are in poverty are in work, they're working. To then penalise them for not finding more work is not the solution. They need the support. They need a decent social security system to lift them out of poverty. So then they have the space and the time and the energy. Living in poverty sucks your energy, it sucks your time, as well as being cash poor. Lifting people out of poverty, particularly out of that deep poverty, allows them the time and space to look at training opportunities, look at additional employment opportunities. But when you're having to go home to your child and make those decisions about, there's another report from Save the Children, you know, telling your children you can't, they're not able to have a bath tonight because there's not enough money in the meter. When that's on your mind, when you're doing your 12 hours on your 0 hours contract, trying to find an extra 5 hours work is not your priority. And then when you've got the DWP telling you, right, if you don't find an extra 5 hours, we're going to sanction that little bit of money you get, that's not conducive to increasing employment and increasing income from employment. Because, as I say, there's two drivers. You need the Social Security safety net, but you also need parents to be able to get a decent income from work, but that can only happen once you've lifted them above that safety net, and at the moment they're way below that and being pushed even further by potential sanctions. So no, we're not pleased to hear that.
Thank you very much. And Morag, did you want to come in on a previous point? I've just remembered.
Well, I think Ed's probably made many of the points that I wanted to make, but that's grand. But if you go back to 2008, the conditionality on lone parents in the welfare system was that their child had to be 16, their youngest child, before they had conditionality on finding employment, and that's now 1 year old. As Ed said, the situation for lone parents is dire because they're doing the work of two parents and they have the stresses of two parents and the responsibilities of two parents, and they're greatly underfunded. This is a policy decision. It is not inevitable that lone parents have to be so poor and so disadvantaged in the system. If you look to other countries, it's not the case. Now, what's an interesting consequence of when lone parents are treated so badly in the system is the effect that you get stigma and shame. So we have a very stigmatised population of lone parents, and the stigma comes from the fact that we treat them so badly in the first place. There's a loop happening here. And if we break that loop on how we treat single parents in the system and understand that they need additional financial supports and structural supports to be able to access employment, then we would also break some of that stigma and the internalising shame that lone parents feel as a consequence. If you look at the employment over the last 10, 12 years since the recession of 2008, you will see that the increase in employment is, there's more increase in employment in women and in lone parents. Their employment rates have increased largely, really a lot in that time. And what has happened, though, is their wages have not. So wages are not keeping a pace with people's level of employment. That's why we have a strange paradox in the UK and in Scotland, where we have high levels of employment, as everyone likes to emphasise, but we have very low levels of productivity and very low levels of wages. And this disproportionately affects women, disproportionately affects lone parents, disproportionately affects disabled workers too. We talk about employability. I would like to have a focus on employability, because there's work that the Scottish Government can do with employers on how they make their employment more accessible, either to people with disabilities, to women with caring responsibilities, to people with children and or other caring responsibilities. Lone parents also are more likely to have a long-term limiting health condition themselves, or a disability, or indeed to have a disabled child. All of these things are interactive. That's where the intersection comes in, and that's the type of analysis and approach that we need in Scotland.
Thank you very much for that, Morag. I've written down employability because I think that's something that we need to definitely chase up. I'm going to move on to our next theme, which is round about the impact of the reduction in spending that we're going to see in 22-23. And to start us off with this, I'll move to my colleague Jeremy Balfour and then over to Pam Duncan-Glancy. Jeremy.
Thank you, Convener. If I can start really with a very direct question. The Convener shared a few moments ago that we have a fixed budget, which is true to some extent, but we also have tax-raising powers to raise tax by 3%. The Deputy First Minister is due to give a statement before the October recess in regard to his response to the government budget at Westminster tomorrow. I would be interested to know from three organisations, would you want to see the government, Mr Swinney, announce a tax increase which couldn't come into effect until the next financial year, but his direction of travel would be that way? Is that something that, as organisations, you would want to see happen to mitigate some of the issues that you have been raising? And I'm happy to start with Ed, if that's OK.
Fine. I guess we're not experts on taxation, but we have started to do more work on this. But the overriding, I think it was Alison, I made a note of what she said, is that before you make any cuts to budgets, you need to first of all maximise available resources. And I think you can even go even further than that. There needs to be sufficient resources available in Scotland to meet the child poverty targets. There just has to be. Not having sufficient resources cannot be used as a reason for not meeting the targets. We look at the spending resource the review, we look at the programme for government. Are there sufficient resources in the system to ensure that we meet that target? And the answer doesn't appear to be yes. So there needs to be more resource. Now, it's an obligation on local authorities, on the Scottish Government and on the UK Government to reduce child poverty. And so there's obligations across the board, but it does appear that he needs to use the powers over income tax, particularly because that's the one that can be changed immediately for the next budget, to ensure there is resources available to deliver. And as we said, that includes increases in the Scottish child payment in April to make sure it retains its real value, plugging those gaps that means some families aren't going to fully benefit from it, like because of things like the two-child limit. But also the forecast, I was trying to find the figures frantically on my phone earlier and I couldn't, but the forecast from the Scottish Fiscal Commission isn't 100% take-up of Scottish child payment, it's around 80%. Now, Scottish child payment isn't like universal credit, where you've got kind of a population, you can do modelling, you can see, right, this is how many people from their incomes might be entitled, this is how many getting it. We know exactly who in Scotland should be getting the Scottish child payment. That information is held by the DWP and HMRC, so there's no reason why every child in Scotland who is entitled to Scottish child payment isn't getting it. So the budget is set on an 80% or an 85% or 90% take-up rate. That should be a 100% take-up rate. So there needs to be more investment. And it appears that there needs to be more resource raised from income tax in Scotland to fund that investment that's needed. And then in the longer term, as Alison was earlier pointing out, there needs to be this fundamental review of taxation in Scotland and how can we fully harness the income and the wealth in Scotland to meet the priorities of the Scottish Parliament. But that work will take time and needs to start now. As you say, an announcement on tax rises today won't kick in till April. An announcement on a review of the Scottish tax powers, you know, if that was to start today, we're not going to be in a position for this budget to do anything about it, and it's unlikely that even in next year's budget we would have done that work. So that needs to start now. Where can we provide resource? I mean, we may come on to it later, but you know, local taxation is one of those things. Wealth taxes is another of those things. As I say, we're not experts, but we're starting to do more and more work on this to get a knowledge, because we're aware that this is something that, as a sector, we need to be calling for. We need to be saying, and this is the human rights budgeting approach, these are your responsibilities. So the question is, how do you fully resource them?
Do you have anything to add, Mark?
Yes, we do have tax expertise in the Poverty Commission, and indeed we have compiled a working group on tax, and we will have a report ready by mid-2023. However, an early paper was shared with me yesterday, and there are a few points I'd like to make, if I may, from that paper. The first is tax administration is tax policy. I hear one of the MSPs stating earlier that tax policy resides with the UK government, and that's true. But this is why we have to be more creative in our thinking in Scotland, because all we ever say is, that's reserved to Westminster, and often we collect data based on what we've already collected before rather than on what do we need to collect now. And a way of thinking about this differently is about how tax is administered. Over the last 10 years, resources have been taken out of HMRC for the analysis of tax evasion, for the chasing down of tax evasion. Now, there's no reason why the Scottish Government couldn't request to have a specific Scotland team, a Scottish team, in HMRC working with Revenue Scotland to focus strictly on the high net worth individuals and corporate tax evasion that we know is happening in Scotland, as per Alison's estimate of £3 to £7 billion. So we could do something about that by not changing the policy, but by changing how tax is administered and by asking for a Scottish specific team to be located in HMRC, because even the Scottish component of that team in HMRC has been reduced, so it used to be there. Similarly, we need wealth taxes, and also if we look at the tax administration point again, transparency drives compliance. As long as people are able to not publish these types of reports, multinationals that may be based in Scotland but reporting profits elsewhere, there's profit shifting. As long as that type of thing is not reported, then compliance is lower. So once we make this a far more transparent system, compliance increases. And I think that's really useful. And of course, the local, I'm sure you'll come on to council tax, but local taxes are key to this too. But I'm guessing you're going to ask about council tax. I won't preempt that at the moment.
Colleague Paul McLennan is probably quickly rewriting some of his questions or figuring out how he can truncate his questions when we get to that. Paul Bradley, do you have anything to add to that?
Kind of general taxation kind of on public is not something that SCBO would be able to comment on, just simply because we don't have that level of engagement with our members on that. But I think any future review would be something that would be encouraging in terms of ensuring that our members can contribute to shaping the direction of tax policy in Scotland.
Thanks very much.
Thank you. My second question is around the specific cut that has been made or announced by the government, Scottish Government, in regard to employment and employability around getting people back into employment, and that cut which is going to take place within this financial year. I don't know if you've done any work particularly around disability and what effect that will have on employability around disability, and is it your understanding that this will affect frontline services, particularly maybe third sector, who have been working in that area a lot, or where do you think those cuts can be made or will be made? And maybe start with Paul, if that's okay, my one.
Yeah, I'm going to follow on with what Alison said earlier on about the challenges of really understanding how the decision was made, and therefore I'm going to try and avoid criticising the decision because I don't feel that I can. I don't feel I've got the evidence. I don't think anyone would say that taking funding away from supporting those furthest away from the labour market into employment is a positive step. I don't think that clearly, as the Deputy First Minister said, that I think the lines were it's not a decision that's been taken lightly. I think to understand whether it's the right decision, I think we need more information on what the cut is going to have an impact on. I'm unsure whether voluntary organisations were engaged in a discussion about the cut that's coming. I'm unsure if there was any discussion about the unintended consequences on different groups, on equalities. I don't know from what's been published whether there's a plan for the reintroduction of that funding at a certain point. So it's not very clear to me on what the impact is going to be. And given, I also recognise that the decision was taken based on where the labour market is just now and low unemployment, but we are on the way to a recession. And while that recession won't necessarily look exactly like the last recession we had in terms of mass unemployment, there is also that balancing between the short-term need, but also making sure that there's the infrastructure in place to make sure that the fallout from any recession is not as bad as it would be. I do wonder, again, around, and this is simply based, I don't know the answer here, but this is the problem with a lack of detail around how decisions are made and the impact, because it then leads others to consider what other reasons are at play. I know that SCBO, when there was the shift to No One Left Behind strategy and the shift to local employability partnerships, our concern was that local employability partnerships weren't ready to be able to deliver that level of employability programmes. I don't know whether that's transpired or not, but I wonder if there is a question around whether progress on that shift to No One Left Behind and local employability partnerships has been slower than was expected, and therefore potentially the saving could be made in that it's not where it should be just now. I don't know if that's the case, but I think that those are the kind of questions that I'd be asking of that particular area on employability.
And I think, Ed, do you want to come in briefly on that for me? Because we are starting to run out of time and we've got loads of questions to get through.
It's a very brief thing, I guess, but in the briefing, the question's posed as, do you agree with that choice to prioritise wage increases? And I guess we've got to remember that low wages are a key driver of poverty as well. We need that investment in jobs, particularly prioritising low earnings and predominantly female areas of employment. But the Child Poverty Delivery Plan makes clear that employability has a key role in reducing child poverty, moving certain numbers of people into work and reducing poverty by a certain amount. So it's important to ensure that those results are achieved. And we don't know what the impact of this cut in investment, but at the end of the day, those results need to be achieved by the employability strategy, which may need further investment, different policies, employability, etc.
Yeah, I mean, and that's something that this committee is highly aware of, because we've just recently launched and our next inquiry is into meeting child poverty targets via employability. So, we are keenly aware. Morag, quickly, and then I'm going to hand
over to quickly.
Pam.
I'd just like to say that the role of employability in tackling child poverty was highlighted in the previous Child Poverty Delivery Plan 2018-22, and we didn't get analysis on how that worked and what the outcomes were from that. So there's a lack of detail and data from the first employability phase. So now we don't know why, what the decision-making was behind the reduction in value on this phase, nor do we know what impact this reduction will have on the funding for 2023-24. Will it revert? Will it not?
Thank you. Pam?
Thank you, Convener. Actually, a number of my questions have been answered, in particular around the employability aspects, but there's a couple of other areas I'd like to explore, if that's okay. And if possible, I'd like to come to Megan first. You highlight some concerns in your submission to us about the pace and scale of action if we're to meet the targets that have been set by Parliament. Can you tell us a bit more about what you would expect to see, notwithstanding the comments that you've already made around there not being enough information for you to really know whether or not we're doing what we said we would, or the government, or rather, are doing what they said they would?
I think what we would like to see is quick action and evidence for the action that's being taken, and an understanding that action being taken will be reviewed in a constant iteration and changed where necessary, where it's not working, because we understand some things are experimental, the new pathways projects, for example, to change things that are not happening and to reinforce things and provide more support and resources when they are happening. When things are happening slowly, if you look at the spending review, there's even those that have increased funding, it's not until 2026-27 or 2025-26, which is after the interim child poverty targets are due to be met. So the fact that a lot of it seems to be backloaded, the child poverty money, and it's not going to give us that pace and scale that we need. It needed to be more front-loaded to get things kick-started fast, and the types of analysis and monitoring and data collection put in place so that we can monitor and track what's happening in situ, in real time, and make those changes, and I'm not seeing that.
Thank you. I really appreciate that. And on a slightly broader point, I guess, have you been able to look at any sort of analysis at all of the flat cash settlement for things like local government and education employability services? Have you been able to do any of that in detail?
No, not in detail, no.
Okay, thank you. The other question I had was around your concerns about concessionary travel. Mm-hmm. And having seen the points you made about worries that perhaps it's made on a reduced patronage because of difficulties, do you have any suggestions for how we could progress that, what we could do, and how to address it?
Yeah. So just to recap quickly, what we said about the reduced money for concessionary travel appears to be in response to a new forecast for reduced demand. And what we would like to know is, why is there a forecast for reduced demand? Mm. Because what we are knowing from people on the ground, from families, is that the under 22 free bus, concessionary bus pass, many people have not been able to apply for it, particularly people in poverty and deprivation who do not have the required documentation, such as passports, etc., to be able to make the necessary application. So what you're looking at already is an inequality in who has access to this. Now, if the reduced forecasted demand is due to the fact that people who need it most are not able to access it, then we would be deeply concerned about that. But at present, we do not have that analysis because it has not been made clear on what basis there is reduced forecast demand. So we would just like some transparency and clarity on why there is reduced forecast demand and asking what could be done. I believe some measures are already in place, and I think this was responded to a bit, but what could be done is children being able to access a concessionary bus pass on the basis of the fact that most of them are in school and have their identity clarified in school or in the doctor's or in the dentist's surgery, rather than making them go through a process of having formal national levels of identification already. So there are ways of doing that, of piggybacking it onto other things they access, whether it's free school meals, whether it's school clothing grant. Yeah. These things should be tied in together. Shouldn't have to keep making applications that are really time-consuming and difficult. We need a more smooth system.
Thank you. That's really clear. I have one final question in this area.
If I can just quickly pick up on that point there, I think there is some really good practice that's happening. My own daughter's school, the school did it for all the children, didn't ask for any identification. And I think that was on, a response to the fact that there was a low uptake. So we know that that can happen.
Yeah.
And it's how we get that that practice rolled out.
Thank you, Convener. I know that a number of schools in South Lanarkshire have done the same. And I think there are examples of where it can be done. So that is really helpful for you to have set that out in that way. My final question in this area, I guess, touches a little bit on the organisational issue that we spoke about earlier on. But some of the submissions that we've seen have said that local government, when they're cash-strapped, which they are, tend to fund only that which they are required to fund through statutory provision. And my concern is, therefore, particularly for third-sector organisations and the work that they do. So I know it's early days, but have you heard of any indication that some of those flat cash settlement may indeed have an impact on some of your organisations, and do you have any plans to monitor it?
Yes, we haven't heard anything just yet in terms of the kind of upcoming kind of annual arrangements around funding, but any static funding for local government is going to have an impact on voluntary sector organisations, either through static levels of funding themselves, and that's where we're seeing organisations perhaps not get an increase in 13 years. That's where we see it, the kind of the worst of it taking place. Or services being cut altogether because funding is needed for ring-fenced areas, and actually voluntary sector services are ones that you can kind of cut away quite quickly, and especially staff on short-term contracts and everything. It just leads to the kind of insecurity for voluntary organisations. So the what we say at a national level about how Scottish Government and other public bodies fund voluntary organisations, I think it's very similar to how local government funds voluntary organisations too. And I think that what we would say is kind of aligned quite similarly to what the Third Centre Interface Network would say. And we are going to be doing some joint work with them around kind of messaging on funding soon. I think the other issue that comes up, and we might see more of, is the use of kind of the procurement system to be able to kind of strip away at all of the kind of benefits that there are in terms of having voluntary sector organisations deliver the public services, and use it as a way to kind of reduce costs. And that feels kind of while I'm not hearing any more examples of that just now, even though it obviously happens, I think that I feel like we're going into that direction where more cuts are going to be needed, and how do you go about that? Rather than using procurement system to improve things like environmental, social and economic kind of well-being, using it as a way to, as a kind of a race to the bottom. And we've seen that over many years, organisations, developing, setting up great services at a local level, and been responsible for taking the lead on those, and then local authorities turning around and saying, oh, we're going to actually bring that in, we're going to retender, and they can't retender on less funding. Mm. And then that organisation that has all the skills and the expertise to deliver it can't then apply for it. So I think that this is the continued challenge.
Yeah, definitely want to keep an eye on. Thank you.
very much for that, and one I have experience of myself in terms of re-tendering and the devastation that caused at the time. I'm going to hand over to Natalie Dawn for the next set of questions, to be followed by Emma Roddick. Natalie. Can't hear you.
That's me now. Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel. And I'm very sorry that I couldn't join you this morning. We've discussed this morning, while the Scottish Government are working on a largely fixed budget, that means that increased spending in one area has to come from another area. So thinking across the Scottish budget as a whole, are there any areas where the members of the panel feel that you think spending could be reprioritised? And I'm going to put that question to each member of the panel, and I'll start off with Morag, please.
Yes, sorry, thank you, Natalie. Yes, so we understand that they're reprioritising spending, and they've already started that. What we would say is that it's important that any reprioritised spending isn't taken away from longer-term action to reduce child poverty. There has to be a balance made between helping families now with the immediate costs and cost of living and immediate pressures, but also not taking the eye off the longer-term ball to enable to meet those child poverty targets of 2023 and then again in 2030. One of the areas we think should be looked at, though, is the attainment challenge funding and how that has been used. It's a £1 billion investment over the course of the Parliament, and to tackle the poverty-related attainment gap. So we'd like to see some increased focus on this funding and how perhaps that could be reprioritised, because children living in poverty are not going to be able to reduce the gap in attainment until their poverty is reduced. I think that people often focus on the words attainment gap and don't focus on the words poverty related. And that's the key part of that phrase, is poverty related. Children who are hungry and cold and stressed and worried and see their parents under tremendous pressure are not going to be able to function well in school. So looking at how that money is spent, how it plans to be spent, again, data analysis, transparency, and seeing can that money be reprioritised, at least some of it in the short term, to protect families' incomes, their well-being, and make sure to solve the poverty bit of the attainment gap. So that's one of the areas we think should be reprioritised.
Thanks, Morag. Yeah, that's very helpful. Can I turn next to Ed, and then I'll take Paul last? Thank you.
I guess, as has already been mentioned both in this panel and the previous panel, that there's an obligation on the Scottish Government to have sufficient resources to meet that bare minimum, that core minimum, and one of the commitments is to the child poverty targets. So they have to have the resources to do that. And if that means it is a fixed budget, but there are tax raising powers, so there are opportunities to increase that fixed budget if that's what's needed and further investment is needed. And I guess, again, it comes back to that information. We can't make decisions about that reprioritisation, because what's important is that every area of the budget is looked at to ensure it's working towards child poverty. So it's not necessarily about reprioritising budget from one space to another, but it's ensuring that when that money is being spent, analysis is being done before policy decisions are made, before prioritising money, so that you can understand the impact it'll have on child poverty. So procurement across budget, across government, from Scottish Government to local authorities, can be used to increase wages or to reduce barriers to employment by ensuring that firms are using best practice. You know, people like, you know, the Women's Budgeting Group, but also, you know, Close the Gap, and there's best practice on having female friendly employment practices. There's best practice on making sure that barriers to recruitment for people with disabilities aren't in place. These don't cost anything, but when you're spending huge amounts of money, as the Scottish Government does, on procurement, you can insist that they're part of the process, and that can help. You know, spending on net zero, that has to be viewed through a child poverty lens, are supports available to low-income households? What's the impact of these spending? So it's not just about taking money from you know, the care pot and putting it into the attainment challenge pot or that. It's about saying, well, we're spending this money in this area. What can that have to meet? And we come back to the national outcomes. What can that have to meet the national outcomes, but specifically these priorities of the Scottish Government of child poverty, along with net zero as well, which is obviously vitally important, but it's making sure that all the spending is supporting these targets, and that comes back to these equality assessments, Fairer Scotland assessments, being done at that very early stage, so decisions are made based on that assessment, rather than the assessment coming afterwards to make sure there's no detrimental impact to any particular group.
Yeah, no, I guess it's difficult because undoubtedly, if you're looking at it from a human rights approach and a child poverty approach, that there may be aspects of the budget that don't necessarily impact on that. So in terms of reprioritisation, it can be extremely difficult because I suppose there could be scope for budget, yeah, for things to be reprioritised and for something to no longer exist or something to no longer, money to no longer get put in a certain pot, as you say. So there are difficulties there. Sorry, I said that. I'll go to Paul and then I've got some further questions on this. Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah, might struggle to get away with reprioritising without losing some of our members. So I think I'll avoid that. And I don't think it's probably our role as a membership body. But the one thing that we have been saying, and we've made clear in the Programme for Government, our submission to the Programme for Government, and to the Finance Committee as well, is that organisations, for us to play an effective role in the society we are and in the system that we're in, we play a kind of mature and positive partnership role with government on issues around budget development and so on. There really needs to be transparent data so we're able to assess the positive, negative or neutral impact that those decisions are having on different national outcomes and indicators. And at the moment, it's just not possible to do that. And I'll give you one example. Last year, there was an £800,000 cut to the third sector resource budget line. Because there is no data about what that fund funds, apart from us knowing that SCBO is part of that, and things like the Social Enterprise Action Plan are part of that, and some other intermediaries, it's difficult to know what that £800,000 cut actually resulted in. So we can't assess the positive, negative or neutral impact of that. And it's actually the same with a more positive example of the increase that's forecasted in the spending review of that budget line up to £27.5 million. If it's additional funding, then that's a positive thing. But we don't know if that's just money moving lines or and therefore we're unable to welcome something from government if it is a positive development. And I just think that it's a real struggle. You know, this is one example, and it's not necessarily linked to the child poverty aspect, but we need to have more open data that also tells the story about where funding is flowing to these different areas to be able to understand the impact and understand what needs to be reprioritized. And you know, the other countries that have open budget portals, I know the Scottish Government Exchequer team, through their Open Government Action Plan, is working on something similar. And I think the committee should take very much an interest in their work on development of an open budget portal to ensure that it does deliver on some of these things that we're looking for and that it is useful. Because at the moment, when I look at the budget, I find it next to impossible to really be able to comment on whether it's beneficial or neutral or detrimental to Scotland's voluntary sector.
Thanks
okay,
for that,
thank you. I definitely wasn't putting you on the spot there, and I'm not asking you to do the government's job of reprioritising, but it's just it's good to hear your input on that because it's such a big issue. So I guess much of my next question had actually been answered, so I'll move speedily on to my last point. I guess addressing child poverty is a clear national mission in Scotland, But what do you think is needed to ensure that we don't lose sight of tackling poverty amongst those people who don't have children as well? So, I mean, I think we all want to live in a society where people are doing more than just surviving. They're living and they're enjoying life, and that goes across Scotland. So how do you feel that we don't lose sight of that? And I guess I'll go to Ed for this one.
Yeah, I mean, I think, first of all, it's right to stress that tackling child poverty should be this national mission. It should be our priority. Families with children are at much greater risk of poverty, and the long-term consequences of poverty on children, it shapes the rest of their lives. So it's great that we have that commitment. In terms of wider poverty, many things we're talking about support all households. So removing barriers to employment. So people with disabilities are far more likely to be in poverty, whether or not their parents, and if we can remove those barriers to employment, and this comes back to the employer ability, you know, why aren't all employers who in Scotland, particularly those who are procuring for public services, using that very best practice to remove barriers both for access to work and in terms of supporting once in work, and that supports many people in poverty. Funding local services supports families, but it also supports wider funding. Advice and information supports all people in poverty. Mitigating the impacts of welfare reform, incredibly welcome. The benefit gap, the bedroom tax mitigation, that helps families, but it also helps other people in poverty. Many of these actions, whilst helping meet the child poverty delivery plan, also help far wider groups than that. And there's not a kind of dividing line between families with children and adults in poverty. You know, the children who are living in poverty are more likely to become adults living in poverty. So if we can deal with, as we talk about poverty-related attainment gap, if we can deal with the poverty part of that, they're less likely to be in poverty in the future. The young adults who are currently in poverty may well go on to have families and become parents of children in poverty. So again, if we can deal with the employability of across the board, particularly for these groups that face additional barriers. And we haven't talked about the barriers that BME communities face into employment as well, another priority group for child poverty, but also poverty in general. So it maps across. We're not talking about it. And I guess one of the other things is in that this moment of crisis, which is hugely impacting on families in poverty, but everyone in crisis, is remembering that commitment we've got to that cash-first approach to supporting households. So the payments, for example, to people on bands of council tax and council tax reduction, supports to the Scottish Welfare Fund, these help families, these are what we're calling for, additional investment in the Scottish Welfare Fund, including the administration of the Scottish Welfare Fund. That helps families, but it also hugely helps people that aren't in poverty. And if you can help households, regardless of whether they've got children or not, over that crisis, they can have the foundation to put things in place to ensure they stay out of poverty. And so investment in that cash-first crisis support is vitally important as well for all households. So often when we're talking about child poverty, the remedies work on a much wider level of society, because I absolutely agree, there's no point in tackling child poverty if when someone turns 18, we go, right, it's not a problem anymore that you live in poverty, because that's obviously not what we want to see.
Thanks for those questions, Natalie.
Thank you.
We are really pushed for time at the moment. Can it be very quick, Maura, because I do have two more people with questions.
Yeah, very quickly, Natalie, everything that Ed said, plus the thought that when we can't do anything about Westminster policies for people without children, or what we can do again is some creative thinking around the edges. So it's been reported to me by people who are working on the front line with the developing the young workforce, for example, that when a person is 18 and they're living in a benefit unit with their parents, but they're now an adult technically because they're 18, their entry into employment or taking up an apprenticeship will have an adverse impact on their parents' benefits and their parents' housing benefit, for example. So what's been reported to me by these people in developing the young workforce is that young people are being unable to take up their offer of a modern apprenticeship because of the adverse impact it will have on their parents' benefit. So the young person's guarantee then becomes null and void, because you can't guarantee it if they can't take it up because of this impact on their parents' benefit. Now, you can try and have influence over the UK benefit system, because I'm sure I wouldn't like to think it's the intention to stop people doing good things and taking up employment at the age of 18. But what you could do is mitigate that impact, and that's something we're not mitigating. So these are the young people aged 18 who are being forced not to take employment because of their parents' benefits situation. So it's about what Ed said about preventing young people in poverty becoming adults in poverty. That's one thing we could be doing right now, is mitigating that by doing some analysis on what the numbers are in Scotland of young people who are in that age group, who are in a benefit unit with their parents, and how much it costs to mitigate. It's a really simple sum that could be undertaken, and that mitigation in place.
Thanks, Morag. I think that was a very helpful example to give to us. And I'll hand quickly to Emma Roddick for a question, and then Paul McLennan is going to finish us off with a very short question, I hope. Emma?
Thank you, Convener. Ed, I just wanted to ask quickly about CPAG's recommendations on spending. There are quite a few, and quite a few are related to mitigation. I wondered, first of all, is there a figure for mitigating the under 25 penalty that you've come to?
No, not yet. It's a short answer. We have one for UK mitigation, and we're doing analysis on a Scottish, working with OPFS and also IPPR on that. So short answer is not yet, but we can probably give that to the committee within a week.
Thank you. Yeah, that would be helpful. And also just on mitigation in general, it was Professor Philip Alston, UN Special Rapporteur on Extreme Poverty and Human Rights, who said mitigation comes at a price and is not sustainable. And given the Scottish Government's current mitigation bill is already to be reported to be over £500 million, do you accept that that is the case?
Not lifting families out of poverty isn't sustainable, and the long-term costs are far higher and fall on the Scottish society, but we'll have to deal with it. Yes, we want particularly the two-child limit, the under-25 penalty, mitigated at source by the UK Government, and we are campaigning on that relentlessly. But in order for the Scottish Government to meet its targets, we don't think it can do that with the drag of on the priority groups, because we've identified quite rightly these priority groups of larger families, young parents, young children, BME communities, which are more likely to be larger families, and these two elements of welfare reform target these groups. So it's no wonder, we know that the inadequate social security is what drives child poverty. We know these groups are not getting sufficient social security because of these policies at a UK level. So if the Scottish Government wants to meet the targets, it needs to mitigate them. I understand there's a cost of that, and hopefully we will get this mitigated at a UK level. But in the meantime, and in order to meet that target, that interim target, the money needs to be invested by the Scottish Government now. And it needs to be seen as an investment, because once you lift those families out of poverty, these lone parents, younger parents, particularly younger parents with larger families, if they're lifted out of poverty now and Maine can get that additional, so that gives them a bedrock to be able to find the employment or whatever it is they're going to do. And so that is an investment now in the longer term that will save the Scottish Government money and as we're pointing out, grow the tax base in Scotland when these parents are older and working. So it's not sustainable not to deal with it as well. There's a cost. There's a cost to not doing something as well as a cost to doing it. And I guess this comes back to the analysis of the budget. If you don't spend this money, what cost is going to fall on the Scottish Government next year, the year after, in 5 years' time, in that 2030 target that you've got? And if you're not helping those families now, you're going to have to spend even more in 5 years' time to meet that very ambitious but reachable target of 10% of people in less than 10% by 2030, which is achievable. That's kind of world beating. That's what, you know, we're almost eradicating child poverty at that level, and we can do it in Scotland, but it needs investment and a plan now, and that includes this immediate support for these families that are stuck in this position.
Thank you very much. Paul?
Be very quick. I was going to talk about taxation. You've already touched on that. I wanted to talk in about fiscal flexibility that you probably heard me talk about in the last panel. One penny rise in income tax would be about £450 million. Even if we increased it by the three pence that we're allowed to do, still wouldn't meet the £1.7 billion inflationary impact we're having this year. So it's really important that we have the fiscal flexibility. One of these key things, obviously, is additional borrowing powers. And one, I think, which could be moved from UK government to Scottish government is about allowances. If we had the ability to raise allowances, we could raise allowances from 12,000 to, say, 15,000, 16,000, 17,000 and take a lot of people out of taxation altogether. So I suppose the key question is, do you support more more fiscal flexibility within that and about the two issues that are raised? One around about allowances, two around about additional borrowing. Just very briefly on that, Ed, I'll see you come in on that one and then I'll go across.
As I say, taxation isn't our area of expertise, so I don't feel confident to comment. What we need is a review to open all this up and look at it and see what can be done and what can't. But the resource, in terms of fiscal framework, the resource has to be provided to tackle child poverty, and whether that's coming from the UK government in the block grant or raised in Scotland, we don't care. It needs to be there.
Yeah.
So I don't know.
What I can then I'll come to Paul.
What I would say is in the Poverty and Inequality Commission, we do have tax expertise. We have a tax working group just forming. We intend to report in the middle of next year. And these are questions that we would be happy to tackle in that working group. If you would like to get in contact with us, we'd be very happy to do so and to do some of our own analysis around that. I can't make any statement on it just now, but absolutely happy to work with you to answer some of these questions.
Thank you. Paul?
Well, I think we're seeing that we're having to make cuts to things that were a priority at the start of the year, and that's because there isn't that flexibility. And I would, just like voluntary organisations, we're calling for greater flexibility in our funding. I imagine the same rings true as well for the Scottish Government along the same lines as well.
Yeah, thank you for being brief. Thanks, Convener.
Thanks very much, and thank you all for your attendance this morning, the evidence that you've given. If there's anything you think that needs followed up, please do that in writing. But Morag, absolutely keen to engage with yourselves in terms of what you just said out to Paul there. Thank you very much. And I now close the public part of this meeting, and we will move into a very quick private session. Thank you very much.